Good morning, everyone. Let's stand up and sing Shout to the Lord this morning.
Wonders of your mighty love.
invite you guys to have a seat and direct your attention up here. We've got another baptism this morning, so praise the Lord.
Hey, man, what a beautiful, beautiful song to start this morning's worship service off, to shout to the Lord. And I tell you, I've been shouting all week because of Mr. Elton Gist. Let me introduce to you Mr. Elton. If you were here last Sunday during the second service, Elton came forward and accepted Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Amen? Isn't that awesome? It's great. I know some of Elton's family is here. If you're part of Elton's family, will you stand up? Let us recognize you. We want to give you a round of applause. Thank you all for being here. Awesome, awesome. You guys can have a seat. Thank you so much. It was a joy to kind of meet with him Wednesday in my office, and we were talking about that step of obedience and baptism, and he said, hey, can we do that this Sunday? And I said, absolutely, and I love it. I love it. I love a life that has changed. And so, Elton, I just have really one simple question for you. Do you know for certain that you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amen. 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 I love it. Yeah. And just in addition to this, I know Miss Carolyn and I were talking too. She's already been saved and baptized, and she wants to join the church along today, along with Elton. So we want to welcome both of you to our church family. It's great. I love it. Love it. Well, Elton, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior, and by your profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Jesus in baptism. Risen to walk. Well, I got you. Risen to walk. Amen. Amen. Woo! Give me a hug, bro. Woo! Praise the Lord. Risen to walk in the newness of life. That's awesome. Wow. Praise the Lord. I could start a service like that every Sunday. Amen?
Amen.
Hey, let's pray together. God, we thank you. We thank you for another life that's changed. And God, I'm just asking, Lord, that I realize in this county, in this area, and even in our church, there are more lives that need to be changed by the power of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, I ask that you will continue to move in the hearts of our people. Lord, I pray that you'll guide Elton in his new life with you. Use him for your glory. And I pray this boldly and confidently in your name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. How are you? That gets gooder and gooder, doesn't it? Isn't that good? I think we're averaging baptism every Sunday.
Let's do it.
And that's amazing. I've asked Pastor Dave, could we just throw some chlorine tablets in there and put some jets in? Wouldn't that be faithful? I think so. We love what God's doing here. Just thankful for people, seeing people be saved. Anyway, then you asked me to do something that I have to pay attention to. That's hard. If you are visiting with us, we would love to have a record of you being here this morning. How are we going to do that? Well, if you will, fill this out and take it to the welcome desk right outside these doors to the left. There'll be a gift there for you. And we want to give you a gift, but the gift to us is that you're here. And we want to know that you're here so we can reach out to you and see how we can pray for you and help connect you to our church. The rest of us, you're not off the hook. How many of you guys got a cell phone? So 4 to 90 has a cell phone, right? Amen. How many of you guys text or receive text? 4 to 90. We need to get your information, church member, your updated information. We need updated phone numbers, home phone, cell phone number, addresses if you've moved, email addresses. We want to be able to email you, text you, call you, send you things. We just want to be able to stay connected to you, and we want all of our information to get to you that's going on in the church. So if you will, give us an updated phone number, address, name, all that, and just tear that off and drop that in the offering plate today. We'd love to get our record straightened out where we know who's here and know where you're living, know what your number is. That would be a blessing to us. Can we pray real quick? Father God, thank you for saving Elton. Thank you for saving all those you have saved and all those that you're going to save. And Lord, I believe with all my heart, as the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is proclaimed, there's going to be more salvations because the gospel's still the power unto salvation for all those who believe, both Jew and Gentile. So that's a promise. I'm reminded in that song this morning, Lord, shout to the Lord about your promises. With everything that's going on in the world today, with everything that's going on in our lives today, I'm hanging on to the promises you've given me and my family and my church family. And I pray today that we would all do that. Be with Pastor Dave as he prepares to just speak and pour out from the bottom of his heart what you've laid in it. I pray that your word would not return void. I know it won't. That it would seek out to do what it's endeavoring to do, and it would be accomplished today. I pray that today would be the day of salvation for somebody who's lost here today. And those of us who are believers, I pray that we would leave here changed and washed by the word. And we go to our homes. We go back into our relationship with you, Jesus, and to our families and our workplaces. More of a light and a witness for you. And we ask all this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand so we sing this next song. This is Everywhere I Go. This is a new song for us. A lot of fun to sing, very catchy, and I hope it stays in your head for a while, because I want you to remember this, that as we're in this study on changing our mindset, putting our minds on things above, if we are mindful that Jesus is with us everywhere that we go, that will fix that. That will change that. That will change the way that we live. It will change the way we think about things. Everywhere I go. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. And I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may, where I go with you. There's a city that calls me by name. There's a city that calls me by name. Yes, as I run this race, I am cheered by the saints. There's a city that calls me by name. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Where I go with you. There's a future that runs through my veins. There's a future that runs through my veins. And there's nothing on earth that can stand in the way. There's a future that runs through my veins. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Where I go with you. There's a spirit I cannot contain. There's a spirit I cannot contain. The same spirit that raised Jesus up from the grave. The same spirit I cannot contain. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Where I go with you. Your breath upon these bones, your fire in my soul, your kingdom is my home. And I don't walk alone. Your breath upon these bones, your fire in my soul, your kingdom is my home. And I don't walk alone. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. Everywhere I go on this road, high pray this, my hope come what may. Where I go with you. Where I go with you. Everywhere 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 I go with you. Where I go with you. Amen. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. What love could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roar. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neither dead, we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou glory and endless delight. I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll sing with me, church. Our Father, we thank you so much for this day that you've given us, and thank you for allowing us to gather together. God, is your body here assembled on earth. Lord, I pray that this body, this group of believers at Leoma Baptist, and scattered across the internet, Lord, that we would reflect you well. God, that we would be a functioning body of Christ. God, that the way we love each other, Lord, would just shine out in the world. God, that we would be a lamp on a hill. That we would be a shining lamp, nothing hiding the light that we have in us. And Lord, I pray that as we're in this mindset series, that you would help us to remember that everywhere a Christian walks, the Lord Jesus is with that person. And I know that can also be a sobering thought for many of us. So I pray, Father, that you would help us to live and to walk in a way that glorifies Christ and does not bring him shame. Because we know that we wear his name and we want to wear it well, Lord Jesus. Because you suffered and died so that we could wear that name. Lord, we give you the honor and the glory and the praise. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for being here. What a great day to see men like Elton be baptized today. I'm glad that you're here with us today. We've been in this series called Mindset, and listen, let me just kind of say this. I think all of us need a mindset change, amen? All of us need to look at things differently. We use that scripture about looking at things above and not looking at earthly things, and today, we're going to kind of stick with that. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn over to Colossians chapter 3. We want to set our minds on the family today. We're going to talk about the family today. And what we're doing here in the series is really, it's about looking at things from a biblical worldview. And by the way, as a Christian, there is no other worldview. The only thing as a Christian we have, the way we should live our lives by is through the Bible, through God's Word. So that's everything that we wear, everything that we say, everything that we do, all the decisions we make. It affects how we go to work. It affects how we go to the voting booths. It affects how we run our marriages. It affects how we go to church. It affects how we run business. It affects everything. Is that biblical worldview? That's what we're going to look at today as it pertains to the family. So if in Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 through 21, there's several little one-sentence statements that are pretty poignant about the family that we're going to dive into today. Listen to what it says. Paul says this in verse 18. Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. There's a lot packed into those few short verses, but here's what I want to kind of start out with today. And just say, I want to say, in order for us to have a godly mindset, for us to have this biblical worldview, we've got to go back and look at God's original design for the family. We've got to look at how God designed husbands and wives, how God designed parenting, how God designed the family. And sadly, We don't have a whole lot of good examples to follow. I mean, even some of us here today, you know, you look back and some of you had a bad mom. Some of you had a kind of not so good dad. Maybe some of you had brothers and sisters that you were always against or at odds with each other. Some of you don't have good families. It's hard to find good model families anymore. In fact, even in the Bible, it's tough to find. In fact, I said this to the church on Wednesday night. There's really only four chapters in the entirety of the Bible that have no sin. Anybody want to know what they are? The first two chapters in Genesis. Those of y'all here Wednesday night know that, right? And the last two chapters in Revelation. Only four chapters in all the Bible that have no sin. But everything in between tells a story after story of people's lives who are affected by sin. Let me just kind of give you a survey of a few of those. You remember Adam and Eve? They're the ones that brought sin into the world, right? And they had kids, and then one kid killed the other kid. Right? That's not a very good example. Then we have Abraham, right? Abraham was God's chosen man, and then Abraham kind of went against God's design for marriage, and he married two wives and then had one of the wives and her son kind of kicked out of the house. I mean, again, that's another bad example. Then we have Jacob, who had multiple wives, and then he had 12 sons, and then the 11 oldest sons sold the youngest son into slavery. How many of you brothers and sisters would like to sell your youngest into slavery, right? I mean, some of you are like, well, that's a good idea. I mean, that's not a good idea. It's a dysfunctional family, right? And then we have David, King David, who obviously had many wives against God's will, against God's design. He had a son that actually raped his sister. And then another son got so mad, killed the son that raped the sister. I mean, total dysfunction. And that's what we have to go in God's word. And so when we consider the biblical narrative, we kind of see a lot of family relationships that are broken by sin. We see that here today in our world today. We see a lot of families that are kind of going against God's design. We have shows on TV that we laugh at and are entertained by that one guy has like four or five wives. And we watch this stuff and we laugh at it. And it's not God's design. We live in a land where the law says it's acceptable to have a homosexual marriage. And guys, I want you just to be real clear today, that is not God's design. It's not what God's word teaches. And so when you distort that, it distorts everything. And so what is God's design for the family? How can we have these relationships with our spouses, with our kids? How can we have a family relationship that is what God meant for us to have? How can our, you know, mindset change as it relates to the family? Maybe the question for you today is this. I'll put it on your handout. Are the relationships that you have with your family, are those a proper reflection of a heavenly standing that you have in Jesus Christ? That's a tough question, isn't it? I mean, if you call yourself a Christian today, you have a heavenly standing in Jesus Christ. Amen? That's a great thing. And so does your family relationships, brothers and sisters, wife, husband, moms, dads, are your relationships a proper reflection of that standing you have in Christ Jesus? And here's what happens. Sadly, a lot of people, when they come to know Christ, you don't see a whole lot of change. And that's sad to me because that's not what the Bible says happens when you accept Jesus. In fact, Paul says it. He says it pretty well in the first part of chapter 3. If you kind of look up a few verses, we read this a little bit last week. But Paul says that if you have a relationship with Christ, folks, listen, it should change everything. It affects everything. He begins in the chapter and he says in verse 1 there, he says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. And so when a believer is saved, folks, there's a radical change that takes place. There's a different mindset. There's a different way of looking at things and thinking about things and talking about things that happen. And it's a new mindset. It changes the way you think. It changes the way you talk. Paul says it this way, verse 2, our kind of focal verse for this whole entire series. He says, you got to look on things above, not on things of the earth. We got to look up. And so this position in Christ, folks, listen, I want to tell you, it should affect everything that we do. The fact that we are believers in Jesus Christ should affect everything. It should change everything. So what about our relationships? What about our family? I mean, our position in Christ should affect our family life. It's a biblical mindset for the family. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at this scripture in Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 through 21, and we're going to talk through these relationships. Let's start with wives. Let's start with the wife's responsibility to her husband. Colossians 3:18 says, "Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord." So first we have the wife's role here. And folks, the wife must submit to her husband because that is the fitting or appropriate position she has in Christ. Can I repeat that? Wives, you need to submit to your husbands. Why? Because it's fitting and appropriate in the eyes of the Lord. Now listen, I get it. That word submission has some really naughty, nasty connotation in today's society. I get that. And we've missed it up. But I want you to understand, submission does not mean inferiority. It doesn't mean that at all. In fact, submit there is a military term. It's a term we use in the military. It's a term to arrange under rank. To come under is what it means. And so when God made the husband and wife relationship, he made it to function properly. Amen? And when it's working, man, it's working, right? But understand that submission does not imply that the wife is somehow less than the husband. That's not what this means at all. Scripture clearly proclaims the equality that we have in Christ Jesus. Galatians 3:28 says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Amen? So I want you to understand there is equality in Christ and there's equality and unity in Christ, but that, folks, listen, that does not remove our roles that we play in the family. And I want you to understand this. At the fall, when Adam and Eve sinned, marriage was broken. This whole kind of submission in the context of a loving relationship was destroyed at the fall. And the result that we see are brokenness in marriages. We see broken lives. We see divorce. And here's what happens. The wife then tries to control the husband. And the husband tries to rule and domineer over the wife. And that's not God's design. The image of God has been just completely distorted through the sin that's happened in this world and in our society. And the homes are broken. And folks, that shouldn't surprise us. When the home is broken, when marriages are broken, guess what else gets broken? Just about everything. The education system then becomes broken. The government system then becomes broken. Why? Because home is broken. So maybe we need to take our marriages a little bit more seriously. Maybe we need to take our homes a little more seriously because home is the foundation of society. By the way, marriage was God's first institution, not the church. It was marriage. God started his building of a community on earth with a marriage between Adam and Eve. And the marriage, when it doesn't work, everything else beyond that gets distorted. And folks, I just want to say, wives, listen to me. The perfect model for submission for you wives is the Lord's submission. Jesus Christ was no less than God the Father. He was fully God. But yet, he willingly submitted to his loving Father. That's your example. Don't let movies, don't let comedies, don't let Hollywood, don't let that be your example. Let the Lord's submission be your example. That's the wife's responsibility to the husband. In the same way, wives, you need to submit to your husbands lovingly. Now let's go with the husbands. We're going to get back to the wives in just a minute. The husbands. What's the husband's responsibility to his wife? It says in Colossians 3:19, "Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them." Do not embitter them, your translation may say. Well, this is the role of the husband. Paul says, husbands, you need to love your wives. And I want you to understand, in the days of Paul, back in the days of Jesus, back in those days, this was a radical teaching. Because back in those days, and it's not this way today, but back in those days, women were really nothing more than just a piece of property. They had no rights. They had no say. It was the man that kind of led. They were really just there. The women were just there to kind of serve the men. So all of a sudden, Paul comes along and says, husbands, love your wives. And they were like going, what? We're supposed to kind of be nice to them and love them and teach them, treat them with grace and dignity? Really? That was a radical teaching. This went totally against the Jewish and the Greek culture of that day. It was a radical teaching. In fact, Paul has to explain it even more in Ephesians chapter 5. Here's what he says in Ephesians 5, 25 through 28. He says this. He says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. How much did Christ love the church? Enough to do what for him? Die. Just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. So Paul gives some explanation here in Ephesians 5 about this role, about how to husbands, how are we supposed to love our wives. So husbands, clue in here in a few minutes, okay? All your wives will high-five me later, okay? Here's the husbands, your love needs to be realistic. That's number one. Your love's got to be realistic. A husband cannot have these unrealistic expectations for their wife. I want you to understand this. Listen, Jesus Christ loved and died for the church even while we were still sinners. And he died for us anyway. Newsflash, who you're married to, they're a sinner. They're a sinner. Your wife, sinner. Husbands, you're a sinner. And so we need to understand that love, and I want you to understand Christ loved us anyway, that's realistic. And so, folks, in marriage, both mates, both husband and wife need to understand this reality. Folks, marriages are being destroyed because of unrealistic expectations that are given to them in the movies and Hollywood and TV. Oh, our relationship is supposed to be like this. No, it's not. Let's stop going to Hollywood for our example. Let's start going to God's Word. And God's Word says, husband, you need to love your wife, right? And you've got to love her through her faults. I mean, the husband's love's got to be realistic. Listen, husbands, your wife has to be reformed every single day because of her sin, and you do too. Amen? That's how it works. The Bible says in 1 Peter 4:8, love covers a multitude of sins. It's love. Think about that in our relationships. What if we just loved each other? What a novel idea. I don't agree with you, brother, but I love you. I don't agree with you, but man, I really love you. Hey, we can agree to disagree, but I love you. What if we did that in our society? What if we did that in our families? Love covers a multitude of sins, so having a realistic love is important for both of you. Don't become disillusioned. I'm convinced that that's why a lot of divorces happen in the first year of marriage. Because there's unrealistic expectations. Here's another one, husbands. Husbands, your love must be sacrificial. You need to be able to die for your wife. Loving sacrificially means you give up stuff because you love your wife. And that bleeds into your time. That bleeds into your entertainment. That bleeds into your friendship. That bleeds into, yes, even your career. It's not more important than your wife. You got to love sacrificially. Here's a third one. A husband's love has to be, listen to this, it has to be purposeful. The Bible says here in Ephesians 5 that Christ's love makes the church holy by cleansing her with what? With the word. Christ's purpose in loving the church was to make us a perfect bride, washing us with the word. Amen? I love that picture. Husbands, that's what you're supposed to be doing with your wives. Lovingly giving them the word, making sure that they're in a Bible-believing church, making sure that they're using their gifts and their talents for the kingdom, making sure that they're growing and serving in the Lord. And you've got to seek to cultivate that, husbands. That's your job. That's your responsibility, is to kind of help your wife figure out what her calling is and what she's good at, and encourage her in that. This love means that you're going to be purposeful. It's purposeful, men. Love your wives purposely. Here's another one. Love's got to be personal, right? I mean, everybody, every man in here got up this morning, you know, you kind of put some good smelling stuff on, you combed your hair if you had hair, you know, and you took a bath. Some of you guys work out and kind of maintain your body. You try to eat well, you run, you exercise. You maintain your body, and folks, a lot of men, it's been years since you've maintained your marriage. And folks, here I want you to understand that Paul's saying, look, in Ephesians 5, he's saying, you love your wife because in loving her, you're loving your own body. So love's got to be personal. And what happens is you go weeks and weeks and months, and you don't maintain your marriage. And what happens is weeds grow up in the midst of your marriage. And it's a mess. And there's conflict. And there's turmoil. And this is what happens. Your love's got to be personal. Now, I know what some of you are saying. Some of you guys are saying, huh, Pastor, you don't know my wife. You don't know. She's not submissive at all. She can't even spell submissive, much less say it. Am I supposed to just force her to be submissive? Well, Paul says, absolutely not. Paul says back in Colossians, he commands a husband to not be embittered, not to be harsh. Listen, it literally reads, if you literally read the Greek, it's stop being bitter. No, you should love her. Love covers a multitude of sins. Remember that? Let love that you have for your wife flow into her and let it just bathe over her. And you might have to love her even on her worst days. You've got to still love her. You've got to love her even on her worst moments, because love, according to 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient as well. It's not instantaneous. It's patient. Patiently love this person. And what would happen? You got to patiently love her, and you patiently got to guide her and lead her and hope that that love kind of smooths over a calloused heart of sin. Now, women, I know you're up there going, what about us? I get it. I know you women have some men that aren't good at loving you. And there's some things in the Bible that speaks to you about that as well. You're supposed to continue to love them. In fact, 1 Peter, I love this, chapter 3, verses 1 through 2, says, wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands so that if any of them do not believe the word. In other words, even if your husband falls off the spiritual wagon, even if your husband says, you know what, I'm not going to that silly church anymore. I don't like that silly pastor. I'm renouncing my faith. I'm not a Christian anymore. I don't believe in this stuff. Even if that's what your husband says, you're supposed to still love him and be submissive to him. That's what the Bible says. It says it this way. It says, they may be won over. Listen to this. They may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives, when they see the purity and reverence of your lives. Elton, you're an example of that, aren't you, brother? He was back there and he said, I don't know where I'd be without my wife. She just loved me. Amen. He said, I never went to church until I met her. And all of a sudden, he's in church. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit's working. And because of her pure, godly behavior, Elton got baptized today. Amen? That's how it works. That's how it should work, church. That's how it should work. So a husband's love's got to be personal. It's a mindset. Listen, I want you to understand, it is a mindset, church. You have to choose to love your spouse. You got to choose to build your marriage on biblical principles, not on what everybody else says or what everybody else is doing. A relationship's got to be built on submission and love. And folks, I get it. Marriages are broken. Marriages are messed up. But folks, we just got to come back. We've got to come back to the creator of marriage. We've got to submit to his perfect plan. That's why we're preaching this message. It's about a different mindset. All right, kids, how many kids we got here? How many kids are living in the home under parents' rule? How many kids? Raise your hands. Raise them high. Be proud. Let's go. Okay, we got hands all over the room. Listen up, children. Listen up, kids. Listen up, teenagers. Listen up, 27-year-old that still lives under the auspices of mom and dad. Listen up. 3:20 says, children, obey your parents in most things. Is that what it says? Nope. It says, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. So it doesn't really give a particular age group here. Most scholars believe that this is referring to children that were living under the leadership of mom and dad at home, whatever that is, whatever age that is. But folks, I want you to understand, children, I want you to understand, if you have a parent that's living in your house, that's their house, you're under their rule. And because Christian children have a relationship with God, as a Christian, many of you Christians out here who are 14, 15, 16 years old, 8, 9 years old, if you're a Christian, you should not be identified by the disobedience that you have towards your parents. Well, that seems simple, but this is interesting because Scripture talks about this in Romans. In fact, Scripture talks about the pagan world that denies God. And they say, that Scripture says that disobedience to parents characterizes that kind of lifestyle. Let me just read it to you. Romans chapter 1, verses 28 through 30. Paul said this, furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. Slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful. They invent ways of doing evil, semicolon, they disobey their parents. Did you read that? Paul says that children disobeying parents marks a world where people deny God. Students, I want you to listen to this carefully. And so when a child-parent relationship breaks down, it is detrimental to the rest of society. And so therefore, a child's obedience to parents, should be strongly enforced. Do you understand that? I mean, listen, we see that in our world today. How many teachers I got in the room? Raise your hand if you're a teacher, preschool. I mean, do you all see the disobedient and disrespect that six-year-olds have toward teachers? Why? Because of the home. How many of y'all work in a workplace somewhere? Do you see the disobedience against bosses and owners and people higher ups? Yeah, you see that. Why? Because the home is broken. And so, children, I want you to understand, students, you've got to obey your parents. Parents, you need to understand that youth development and strategic discipline is so vitally important. Let me kind of add something else to that. Anthony Potts is our student pastor, and Alicia Moore as the preschool and children's director. That's not their responsibility. It's the parents. Student pastors, teachers, directors of preschool and children, those are there to kind of come alongside you parents and help and encourage and love and provide them things, but that's not their responsibility. That's your responsibility. That's your responsibility. Listen, I was a student pastor for a long time, Anthony, and I got blamed for not raising a kid the right way. I'm like, it's not my kid, it's yours. You know, I've got 2 hours a week with him. You've got 50 or so, you know, or more. You know, come on. And so I just want you to understand this. I mean, that's why we have student ministry. It's why we have preschool and children's programming, so we can love kids, disciple them, and point them to Jesus. But parents, that's your responsibility. Let me just kind of jump into that, because that's Colossians 3:21. Lastly, it says, fathers, do not embitter your children. Do not provoke your children, some of your translations may say, or they will become discouraged, or they will lose heart. So Paul here is still addressing this parent-child relationship, right? And Paul speaks specifically to fathers here, and he commands them not to provoke their children, lest they become or lose heart or become discouraged. Now, I want you to understand, parents, this is not just being angry. Listen, you're going to make your kids angry. Amen? Amen. Can we have Fruit Loops for lunch? No. Can we have Twinkies for breakfast? No. And they're going to get what? Angry, right? So I'm not talking about not making your kids angry. Anger is an emotion we all have. But what this verse is talking about is this is that deep-rooted, settled anger that sets in and stays with a child and affects who they are for the rest of their life. And Paul says here, don't provoke that. Don't cause that. It should be noted, by the way, moms, listen. It should be noted that the word father there in Colossians can also be translated parents. In fact, that same exact Greek word is used in Hebrews 11:23 when it says Moses' parents hid him for 3 months because they saw he was not an ordinary child. So folks, yes, I understand Paul specifically says fathers here, but I want you to understand that's a Greek word that's translated into parents. Yes, fathers, I'm a father. I can make my kids angry and I can provoke them to anger, but so can moms. So as parents, we've got to be careful about that. This is not a sin just committed by fathers. It's a sin committed by mothers. And it's possible for a parent to so embitter a child that they become heartless. They become embittered. They get discouraged. So let me throw out some ways you parents that have kids, maybe you grandparents can pay attention to this too, of things not to do. I mean, because parents embitter their children, one, by not disciplining them. You've got to exercise discipline. Parents embitter them by never driving out what I call the foolishness of sin from their lives. You've got to stop that as parents. You've got to understand, make your kids understand what sin is and drive that out of them. Folks, if you don't discipline your kids, you're going to grow up one day and your kids are going to rebel against you and you're going to wonder, what did I just do? What just happened? You've got to discipline your kids now. Here's another way. Parents embitter their children by abusing them or giving improper discipline. You know, when a kid spills milk on the floor, you can't ground them for a year and a half. That's just not, it doesn't make sense, does it? But there's got to be proper discipline, but also we can't drive the line and get over that and kind of be abusive. We've got to be very, very careful about us as parents, ready? Disciplining our kids when we're very, very angry. You won't like me when I'm angry. Right? And I've had to learn this as a dad because I have made many, many mistakes as that. My kids will tell you, yes, dad's made a lot of mistakes in that. But I've got to understand, I've got to calm down because I don't do well when I'm angry. I've got to calm down. And folks, I want you to understand when you are anger and you're raising your child up and your child's fighting everybody and they're holding grudges against everybody, why is that? Well, it's probably because you discipline them in anger. Parents also embitter their children by neglecting them. And we see this a lot in our busy, busy culture that we live in today. Career, jobs, hobbies get in the way of our kids. And folks, we've got to be careful about that. Folks, we can't embitter our children. You've got to prioritize them over your hobbies and over your work. The only thing that comes before your kids, listen, the only thing that comes before your kids is your God and your spouse. That's biblical. It's God, spouse, kids. God, spouse, kids. I don't care if that's a blended home. I don't care if that's it's God, spouse, kids. That's how it works biblically. So you can't neglect them. Here's another one. Parents embitter their children by never, ever, ever encouraging them and showing them affection. If you're going to be a healthy parent, you've got to not only discipline your kids, but you've got to also reward your kids. Parents, when was the last time you rewarded your kids? When was the last time you said, hey, guys, we're just going to Dairy Queen. We're all going to get banana splits. We're just going to eat until we just can't eat anymore. You got to reward your kids, not just on birthdays, not just at Christmas, but you got to reward them. You know what that teaches a kid? When you discipline them in a healthy way but also reward them, it teaches them a fairness of life. It teaches them a balance. It teaches them that you don't get your way all the time. Another way that parents embitter their children is they show favoritism. Anybody have multiple kids at home? Yeah? And like in private conversation, you're like, I really like her the best, or I like him the best. Have you ever done that? And then it acts out, you know. And folks, we can't do that. We can't show favoritism. Listen to what Paul said in Ephesians 6:4. He says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. So parents, instead of developing bitterness in your kids, why don't you train them about the Lord? What's that look like, Pastor? Here's what it looks like. You're sitting at home and you're watching TV and you got a big old bowl of popcorn and a TV show comes on and something very sinful, very unbiblical comes on the TV. And as a parent, you could take that opportunity to have a teaching lesson. Why was that wrong? What was that all about? What'd you think of that? And you can get out God's word and you can train your kids in the way of the Lord. Folks, it's a proper mindset. It's a sense, folks, listen, parents, listen. Your kids aren't even yours. They're God's. And he said, I want you to steward these little urchins. These three are yours, and these four are yours, and these two are yours, and this one, you only get one. That's yours. That's what God does, and he wants you to steward them. They're not ours, and we got to take that seriously. And so here, I want us to understand, this is a mindset change, church. It's a mindset for husbands. It's a mindset for wives. It's a mindset for parents. It's a mindset for students and children in the home. Paul here is giving a proper biblical worldview in Colossians chapter 3 for members of the family. And I want you to understand something. Let me just kind of close with this and say this. Hey, wives, when you submit to your husbands, it has nothing to do with whether or not your husband is a good or bad husband. Hey, husbands, when you love your wife, it has nothing to do with whether or not she's a good or bad wife. Hey, children, when you obey your parents in everything as is pleasing to the Lord, it has nothing to do with whether your parents are good or bad. Because that's a worldly mindset. That's a mindset that says, you mess with me, I'll mess with you. You made me mad, I'm going to make you mad. You hurt me, I'm going to hurt you. That's earthly. Folks, we've got to do everything we do as a husband, as a wife, as a father, as a mother, as a child, and having parents. We've got to do everything we do because we have a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's a different mindset. So you wives that have husbands that are a struggle to submit to, it's because of your internal relationship with Jesus Christ that you can submit to him and love him. Husbands, for those of you who have that ornery wife, it's hard to, you know, hard to love. You're only going to do that because of your internal personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Hey, kids, listen, I get it. Parents make mistakes. I've made many. And I'm not a good dad sometimes. But you obey anyway because of your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Oftentimes, I think what happens in this world is our responses are based on what other people do to us instead of our relationship with Christ. And you're going to get in a lot of trouble doing that. Folks, you can't control other people. Did you hear that? But you can control your faithfulness in God. Your faith has to mean something. So if you're a husband, your faith needs to mean something in your relationship with your wife. If you're a wife, your faith needs to mean something in your relationship with your husband. If you're a sixth grader, a tenth grader, a four-year-old in a home, your faith has to mean something as you relate to your parents. If you're a parent, your faith needs to mean something as you raise your kids. Folks, we've got to get back to a mindset of the family. We've got to look at things above. Let's get a new mindset for the family today. Let's not do things based on what everybody else is doing, because you're going to be disappointed every single time. Don't say, I wish I could be like that family. I wish I could be like that family. I wish I could be them. I don't want to be them. I don't want to be, you know. No. Let's say, I want to be like Christ. I want my mindset of my family as a husband, as a mother, as a wife, as a child, as a parent. I want my mindset to be that of things above. That's a different mindset. So wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives and don't be harsh toward them. Children, obey your parents in everything. And parents, don't embitter your children. Listen. If you're sitting here today and you don't have a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, none of this makes any sense at all to you. Because the only thing that makes sense to you is just to live like the world lives. And the world says, you know, you treat me bad, I'll treat you bad. That's it. So if that's you, if you're here today and you don't, you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, let me tell you the one and only thing I would love for you to do today is to really consider turning your life over to Jesus Christ. Consider surrendering your life to Him. And you can see how things will incredibly change in your family. So if that's you today, the invitation will be in just a few minutes. Pastor Anthony will be up here. I'll be up here. You can come and just say, you know what? I just need to be saved. Maybe you're here and you need to take that next step in your spiritual journey. Maybe you saw a baptism today and you said, you know what? I need to be baptized. I've never followed through with that. I need to be baptized. If that's you, you need to come forward and say, you know what? I need to take that next step in my spiritual journey. Maybe you need to join the church today. Maybe there's a lot of things you could do. But I also believe that there's a lot of Christians here that are believers in Jesus Christ. Christ is in you. And you've realized today that in those family relationships, maybe it's with your spouse, maybe it's with your kids, maybe it's with your parents, you are struggling. And you're basing everything in your relationships in your family on what other people have done to you. And maybe for the first time, you need to kind of come into a realization that it's not about what anybody has done to me, it's what Christ has done for me. And Christ died for you. He loves you. And because of that intimate personal relationship with Christ, maybe your relationship with your spouse, maybe your relationship with your kid, maybe your relationship with your parent needs to be different. And so maybe during this invitation, maybe you husbands need just to grab your wife's hand and say, you know what, we're going to come to this altar and we're going to pray together. And maybe you've never done that. Maybe that's weird to you. Maybe that's just strange to you. And you don't have to have some kind of eloquent prayer. You could just come and be silent and just kneel at the altar. I think your wife would get it. Maybe some of you need to grab the wife and kids and say, come on, let's go pray. And here's what I'm going to take, because some of you are going to do that. And some of your kids are going, don't do that. Let this be the first step of obedience to your parents. And trust your dad, trust your mom, that they're going to take you up there and they're going to bathe you in prayer. And they're going to love you through this process of being raised as a kid. And wives, don't look at your husband and go like this. Take that as a first act of submission. And say, you know what? My husband wants to pray for me. I'm going to let him. Hey, husbands, don't sit there and go, I'm not doing that. That's crazy. That's the silliest thing I ever heard. I'm not doing it. Why don't maybe for the first time you rise up and be the man God's called you to be and lead your family? Be the spiritual leader, not the domineering dictator leadership leader of your family, but the servant-minded leadership of your family, the spiritual leader of your family. Maybe you could just kind of huddle up right there where you are and just pray together. I don't care how you do it. But folks, we need a mindset change as it comes to the family. We have to have a mindset change. We've got to start looking at things above, not on things of the earth. Wives, be submissive. Husbands, love your wives. Children, obey your parents. Parents, don't embitter your kids. Don't discourage them. Let's stand and pray. God, your word has spoken loudly and clearly this morning. And I'm just asking, Lord, that all over this room, that right now in the stillness of this moment, as some soft music will begin to play in just a moment, that, Lord, I pray that you will be convicting hearts. And, Lord, I do pray that if there's somebody here that's never surrendered their life to you, that, Lord, today will be a day of salvation for them. Today they will come and say, you know what, I've never accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Today is the day that I need to make that happen in my life. Maybe somebody else here needs to take that next step in their spiritual journey to join the church, to be baptized, or whatever that step is. But God, as we've talked about the family today, I'm just moved by maybe the fact that there's some families here that need to kind of readjust. That their mindset has been on things of the earth and what so-and-so did or what so-and-so did or what so-and-so did. And maybe our mindset needs to be on things above. And we need to think about our relationship with you and what that means. And maybe families today just need to grab each other's hand and just kind of gather together. Maybe they need to come to the altar. They just need to gather as a family and say, you know, God, we want to have a biblical worldview. Husbands, I pray that, God, you'll convict them and help them to love their wives. As Christ, you loved the church and died for it. I pray there's some ladies here that just maybe kind of reach over and grabs her husband's hand and just says, you know what? I love you and I love your leadership. Let's do this life together. Maybe there's some kids here that have been disobedient that maybe just need to go up and grab mom and dad by the hand and say, you know what? I'm going to be obedient to you from this point forward. I'm going to honor Christ in that way. Maybe there's some parents who just need to kind of huddle up with their kids and just say, I love you. We've messed up. From this day forward, we're going to go in a different way. We're going to have a different mindset. We're going to start looking up. We're not going to be that dysfunctional family. We're not going to be that statistic. We're going to be that family who loves the Lord and loves each other and lives it out. So God, we ask just in this moment that God, you'll speak to our hearts. I pray this in your name.